Last week I gave a ton of examples for engineering situations where we have huge amounts of data to deal with, like distillation columns, refineries, and so on. But there's also many other examples where data really is overwhelming. And this is a nice one that I came across recently. This is in France, the Meulovie Viaduct. It connects Paris to Barcelona on the expressway there. And this is a bridge where there's several of these pylons. This pylon over here is the second one in a series of, I think there's 7 or 8 of them. This one here in the middle is taller than the Eiffel Tower. And this is just another view of it. So it's about 2.5 kilometers long. And there's another aerial view showing. It's pretty impressive. I mean, Mike, if I go to France next, I will show it. I want to travel through this area. Now, they've really instrumented this thing up. It's built recently, so they've got all this technology to put on anemometers, accelerometers, inclinometers, extensiometers, which measure stress and strain, and various temperature sensors. So these detect any movement right up to the micrometer level, and they monitor for any oscillations that get set up by winds and other phenomena. They've also got all these sensors in the roadway to collect traffic data. And they're able to detect, using those sensors, various weights and speeds of the cars, the density of the traffic on the road. And they claim that they can distinguish between 40 different types of vehicles. So we have this in engineering as well. We often collect lots of data and we want to be able to predict, is this good operation or bad operation? Here in this case, they're collecting all this data and they've been able to predict 14 different outcomes. Is it vehicle type A, B, C, D, E, and so on. But in engineering, we have a very similar situation. Predict is the operation good, bad. Maybe you've got different levels, not just good and bad. What's also surprising is just how much of data they collect. They collect over 100 readings per second just from that main pylon. So this is this main pylon, the second one over here. It carries the most load in the whole bridge structure, so that's the one they really monitor closely. 100 readings per second, and all the data is transmitted by fiber optic means. And there's about 20 kilometers of fiber, I think there's 30 kilometers of Ethernet cable and so on. So it's pretty impressive, data collection and data processing. There's another example from Formula One racing that I came across this weekend. So for these racing events, each car is instrumented with roughly 100 sensors. And the data is transmitted from the car to the pit in real time, about 4 to 6 megabytes of data transmitted per lap. And the rest is collected, the rest of 20 gigabytes comes when they connect the car back up to the network where it comes in. So they have 3 servers continually crunching the data. They've got about 20 other servers just handling the rest of the computer facilities. And then this data is also transmitted in real time to the home base in the United Kingdom where they number crunch through the data. As the driver is going around, they send the driver various signals called advisories. They cannot tell the driver what to do, or they cannot tell the driver do this, do that. All they can do is create a dashboard on the steering wheel, and they can react to that. So again, it's real-time process monitoring would be the equivalent to chemical engineering. Or another example is aircraft. An aircraft is always at least triply redundant. Sensors, control systems, and computer systems. Computer systems on an aircraft are usually 5-fold redundant. And they all cross-check each other to make sure the calculations are done correctly. And there's a recent paper out in Control Engineering Practice, which is a pretty good journal to follow if you're into this sort of stuff, which talks about using PCA, Principal Component Analysis, and another tool, Common Filtering. And this just is for diagnosing the engine. But of course, there's all sorts of other data collecting on the aircraft. So, I mean, this is all very relevant because our plants are moving, newer plants are moving to these wireless sensors, wireless computer systems, as in used in this Formula One case study. We're collecting all this data, and what are we making of it? We're trying to make decisions in real time or as close to real time as possible, or at least use this data to help us support the decisions we make as engineers. So that data just advises us in some way and gives us extra input. But what we're looking at in today's class is this tool PCA to effectively deal with this large amount of data. That's solely what I'm talking about today, just PCA and how do we cope with the big quantities of data. Now, I know that the examples I'm going to be talking about today are small. There are going to be six variable examples. But we have to start off that way because I'm going to show you the raw data and then the PCA next to it, and then you'll be able to validate your understanding of PCA next to the raw data. I can't do that for some of the real data sets that we work with, which are 200-300 variables. It's just not feasible. So we're going to start with small. You'll always see in my examples two components. That's often one question people ask. Does PCA always have to have two components? Well, no, because the examples I'm dealing with, two components is the size that they come out to be, and it's easy for us to visualize two components on scatter plots and so on. But these methods are equally applicable to the situation where you have hundreds of sensors and more than two data variables. So I know in the last class it was pretty empty. I guess people had all sorts of projects. So I've decided I will just backtrack a little bit in the notes and go over some of the concepts quite quickly though. But at least it gives you a chance to just refresh some of this. So we looked last time at what's a latent variable. And in page 8 of the notes, this is the first example I gave you. Imagine your health is a latent variable. It's something you cannot measure directly, but you can infer what your health is from a whole variety of other measures. So I listed a few here, and there's plenty others that doctors and nurses and so on can measure. Blood pressure, cholesterol, weight, blood sugars, various ratios or measurements on your body, temperatures, and so on. In fact, you could probably say all of these together make up one latent variable called health. But you could probably say well, there's probably other latent variables, like fitness or blood condition, where you just take the variables related to your blood, like blood pressure, blood sugar, and other quantities related to your blood. That would be itself a latent variable that you could say, this is the health of my blood. Or you could take various numbers that quantify your fitness. For example, the ability for your body to take in oxygen and the oxygen level in your blood. So those are various types of abstract measurements, abstract concepts that we can't work on directly, but they form latent variables. The variables we happen to measure on the system, they'll be correlated with the latent variables. So that's why all the stuff in today's class, you'll see me constantly referring to directions of variance. It's because the latent variable, which we cannot measure, we assume it forms that direction of greatest variance. All the other variables that we can measure just happen to go or are correlated with that direction of variance. So when we look at these directions, think of them as abstract things that it would be great to measure directly if we could, but because we can't, we resort to 3 or 4 or 5 or more measurements, and we hope that those measurements we do measure are correlated with the quantity we cannot measure. Okay, so I'll keep repeating that quite a few times, because I know the first time you see this stuff, thinking about data multivariately is a little bit of a step beyond what we're used to doing every day. We're so used to thinking one at a time, and cause and effect. If I change this, then that happens. I'm changing one thing and I see a reaction. But when it comes to multivariate data analysis, you're not actually able to change one thing. And I'll show you with an example towards the end of the class. Is in many real cases, when we think we're changing one thing, we're not changing just one thing. We're also changing several other things inadvertently. So I hope that, for those of you that get the material, that you might be bored towards the end of the class and it might be repetitious. And the notes are certainly a bit repetitious as well. But I hope to at least convey the general concept to you, because that's what I want to get from this class. Just to think of it multivariately. The other example that I introduced last week was this idea of 4 temperatures, say, in this room. And you notice that there's this oscillation in the 4 measurements. Just ignore those blips over there for now and maybe the spike in the data. But apart from those, we've got these four sensors that move up and down together. So we said last week that one way that we might summarize these four temperature measurements is to use an average of the four. I mean, that's obvious as an engineer, you would do that right away. So you could say temperature one, I'll call that X1, times 0.25. So a quarter times the first temperature, a quarter the second, a quarter the third, a quarter the fourth. And that combination of the four temperatures gives me an average temperature T1. And if we write it out in matrix form, we get the same terminology. And we get, we write it up with this equation over here, T equals XP. And we said that the T, the average temperature, is a linear combination of the original measurements. So a linear combination of these original measurements given by the weights in P. So that's standard terminology when we're talking about linear combinations, is that something, in this case, the average temperature, something is a linear combination of its raw data, the x's, given by the weights in the vector P. So when you see something like this, a dot product, it's a linear combination given by those weights in the other variable, in P in this case. And I used this illustration last week to talk a bit about it, PCA, from geometric point of view. Let me recap here what's going on. So we have three variables. If I had to record this in a matrix, I would have my matrix X with three columns, column X1, X2 and X3, and in each row I have three numbers, of course. So what I'm plotting up here is the scatter plot in three dimensions for one row at a time. So each point represents a row from the middle of X. So we have a collection here, say 50 data points, 50 rows in X, which we call N. So N is about 50 in this case, and K, the number of columns or variables, is 3. The first step we do is to find the mean. The mean is found by calculating the mean from the first column and recording it, the mean from the second column, recording that, and the third value. And we get a new data point, or a new observation, a fictitious observation, you can call it X bar if you like. And that's the point in there in the middle. So we then go and say, subtract the mean from every row in X. What this means then is we create a new matrix, X, where the first row is the first row from this matrix minus the mean. The second row is the second row from this matrix X minus the mean. And so on. We proceed to just shift our coordinate system to the origin. That's what mean centering it is, and we've seen that plenty of times in this course already. We also do a scaling step where we divide each row by another vector of three numbers called the scaling vector, and usually that vector is the standard deviation of the data. And I'll talk a bit about centering and scaling further on, but once you've mean centered and scaled the data, your data now is centered at the origin, and each column will have variance of 1. And dividing through by the standard deviation also gets rid of the problems with units and so on. If I had measured the first column in kilograms, I'm dividing through by the standard deviation that's also in kilograms. If I had chosen to record that in grams, I'm dividing through by a standard deviation in grams. After I've scaled the data, I lose all my units. So this new X matrix that I'm dealing with over here has no units. Each column has zero mean and unit variance, and no units. And that's true for every column. It's also what really allows us to combine measurements from dissimilar systems. For example, the first column could be a temperature, the second column could be a pressure, and the last column could be a flow rate. If we don't center and scale the data, it's kind of weird to combine various units and various properties from the system. But by scaling, we now get new columns which are dimensionless, they're just new forms of data. then the first step of PCA is to go fit the finest direction of greatest variance. So there's that's the first requirement, is that it passes through the origin, and then it also goes in the direction so that it best explains the data. So it's the first requirement, it passes through the origin, and secondly, it fits the data in to give you the lowest possible error. And we quantify that error by calculating a projection of each data point at 90 degrees to this component. So every row in our data set would project at 90 degrees to this direction. And these residual distances, one for every point we add and sum and square those, that residual distance, or distances, is minimum. Another way to interpret this is to consider this distance from the center point all the way to the location where that projection meets the line. We call that a score value. So this observation over here has a score value given by that distance. So this might have a negative value, say negative 10, might be the distance from here all the way to over here. This observation projects onto the line, we have a score, say, of minus 9, minus 8, 7, 6. The midpoint has a score value of 0, and these points out here have positive score values. So if I collect these score values, that's my T1. I get a new column with n rows, because my original matrix X had n rows. So I get a new column T1 containing the score value for every observation. Another way to interpret what this first component is doing is it's finding that direction so that the variance of T1 is maximum. There's no other line through this coordinate system that gives a greater variance than this one over here. So it's interesting, there's two ways to see it, two equivalent ways. The line that fits this data with minimum residual distances, so if you sum the squares, is also the line that maximizes the variance. The two, they're trading off. If you increase the residual distances, your variances will get smaller. So the line that meets both those requirements is the identical line. It's the same line in each case. So that's a nice way to interpret PCA, is it's doing both these jobs. And sometimes when we're looking at the properties of PCA, we'll use the one way of thinking about it, that it's minimizing error. In other words, is that it's a predictive model. When we're minimizing error, we're trying to predict something. We're saying it's a prediction error. So that's one way to visualize PCA. The other way to visualize PCA is to see it as a method that's finding these directions of greatest variance. Now, this comes back to this question of why is the direction of greatest variance of interest to us? It's like I said earlier, usually the latent variables in our system, the variables that we cannot measure, but that drive the system, that cause it to move around, whatever that phenomenon is, for example, in the room temperature case, there's something that's causing the room temperature to oscillate. Maybe it's the sunlight coming in through the window, and the amount of sunlight. We don't measure that directly. But that's what's driving the system up and down. Usually these phenomena that are hidden or latent in the system are the ones that cause the greatest directions, cause the greatest movements in the system. So that's why we choose to find these directions of greatest variance, because the likelihood is that they're correlated with whatever's driving these systems around. So in a distillation column, what's driving at the distillation column in terms of the process data? What factors do you think might be causing the 50-60 variables that you measure in a distillation column? One way to visualize it is, say you're sitting in a control room at Petro-Canada, and they all have on their screens several time series plots. So here's variable 1, variable 2, variable 3. And they'll maybe have, say, 50 variables. They'll have these strip charts going for a distillation column. What do you think causes this variation? I mean, if nothing caused the variation, we'd be recording flat lines, and the engineers would be great. They'd be happy, nothing to do. But there's always variability in the systems we record. For a distillation column, what might you think causes this movement in the data? Any suggestions? But is that a cause? So what's driving, say one of these variables is the temperature. What might be driving the temperature? Yeah, so there's definitely correlation. Steam flow, so that's something that's manipulated, right? So that's an energy input. So when the steam goes up, the temperature goes up in the reboiler, and all the variables at the bottom of the column, they also start to increase as the reboiler starts to go back up. Any other?
Pressure.
But again, is that a driving force, or what is causing the pressure to change? So cooling water.
In the composition,
great.
That's it.
Okay. Exactly. So the raw material characteristics that cause the system to move up and down, the energy inputs manipulated by the process operators or the control systems, those are what's driving your system up and down, causing these temperatures to move. So if you looked coming back to this example with the temperatures at the bottom of the column, you would see them do this, they'd all move together. So you'd have several temperatures doing that. If you looked at just that temperature data, that's going to be the predominant source of variability in the system. That's going to be your first latent variable, or maybe your second latent variable. So you could find, for example, that your first latent variable is associated with variables that are due to the energy balance in the column. And your second latent variable shows variables that are related to the feed composition, or correlated with changes in the feed composition. So that's one reason why we look at these directions with greatest variance, is because those are often what's driving the system, and all the other variables that we just happen to measure, all these many, many columns in our matrix X, so we've got these K columns in matrix X, so several of them are related to the driving force due to energy input, others are related due to the feed composition. They're not going to be nicely in this order, grouped together, but what PCA is going to find out which of the columns are related with which directions of variance. And that's what by the middle of this class today, we're going to be able to show how that comes about. How can you find out which variables are related with which direction? Okay, so we take the second component then after we've done with the first. The requirement on the second component is that it also passes through the origin. It also has to fit the greatest direction of variance, but it's constrained to be perpendicular to all the preceding components. So in this case, we just have one component ahead of it. So it has to be orthogonal to this component. It has to pass through the origin. And then after that, we're free to rotate it anyway through that circle. We keep that one fit, and we keep rotating this component around until we find that it explains the greatest amount of variation. What do we mean by that? For the second component is that if we take these observations again and project it now onto the second component at 90 degrees, we take this observation and bring it back down here, it's going to have a small value. We call these T2 this time. This is going to have a T2 value of, say, plus 5. This is a T2 value of plus 4, plus 1. That's going to be a 0 T2 value. And that point up there is going to have some negative T2 value. So we've gone and taken our X matrix, which I'll leave up here. And we've now gone and found a new column, call it T1. And we found a second column, call it T2. So the same number of rows is like X, there's n rows. We find n score values, T1 from the first component, and n score values from the second component that follow these rules of the PCA. And then we can also visualize this geometrically as the first component and the second component is forming a plane in this three-dimensional space. So we still need in the k-dimensional system, in this case, k is three. But we found a plane inside this three-dimensional world, a two-dimensional plane inside a three-dimensional system that best approximates all the data. So that is the second component. And then you could go fit a third component to the system, and then you have to stop. You can only find as many components as you have variables. You can't go beyond that. So in general, for a k-dimensional system, a matrix, say with 50 columns, we can find component 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. The third component is constrained to be orthogonal to the first component and the second component. So each successive component is orthogonal to all the previous components. And that's interesting because what it says is each component is in a direction that's totally new. We've not gone in that direction before. It's extracting new independent information from the system. And last week I had this example of the rotating cubes. This is a three-dimensional system where I've taken temperature 1, 2, and 3 that I showed originally. I had four temperatures in the room. I'm just using the first three. And I had this little video that kind of spun around to show what it means. So as we're rotating these three temperatures measurements around, we ignore the blue points and the red points for now. They're outliers. But the black points form those that sinusoidal pattern we saw. So let me just freeze it here for a minute. Okay, so over here we have temperature 1, 2, and 3. So this is going from low temperature to high temperature. If I plot them together, it's clear that the first component is going to go in that direction. It's the greatest direction of variance in the system. So that's one way to visualize it. Three dimensions and four dimensions, the same concept holds. And we call, instead of, so in the first component would be the line, the second component would be for the plane, and then the third component is what we call a hyperplane. Okay. Then, in the last class, I ended off a bit by talking about some geometric concepts. I'll just go through these again quickly. Because I feel this is an important way to understand why we're heading towards this idea that you can say t is equal to xp. This you'll see recurring in the notes all the time. I don't just want to put it down there and say believe it. I just want you to understand a bit about why, where it comes from. So when I drew that first direction of variance, the first component, I'm going to draw my coordinate system over here. So this is my origin, and the first component went in this direction, call that P1. And we have an observation, we'll call it Xi, over here. So Xi is just a single row from the matrix X. So I take that row, that's row Xi, and it's the one by K vector. We call it Xi constant. So that's a vector. I can draw a point from the origin up to that. And that's the first, that's all, just one of the observations in the system. Now, by dropping a 90 degree to that first direction, I form an angle over here called theta. And from geometry, we know that theta is, or the cosine of theta, is given by the adjacent distance divided by the hypotenuse. Now the distance on the adjacent side is this distance over here, from the origin to to that point. So this distance over here, the distance recorded is just a scalar, it's not a vector. It's given by that. And that was what we had at TI. So that T is the score value for this this observation. Bringing it down to this direction vector P just gives me my score value, TI. And I call it TI1 because I'm projecting along the first two points. The hypotenuse is this length over here. And that length is given by this notation here, which the norm of XI. And just in case you haven't seen this before, the norm of the vector quantity is the sum of squares of the entries inside the vector. So that's the cosine of theta. We also have that from linear algebra, or matrix algebra rather, we define the dot product of two vectors using the cosine rule. So the cosine of theta in this case, using that would be xi transpose p1. So the dot product of xi times this vector p is defined by the cosine of theta. And there's usually scaling factors up here, xi, and then pi, p1. So it's the product of those times that. So I'll just divide through by, and then over here. So if I bring it to the denominator, xi. And if we now equate these two, so cosine of theta, xi, pi, I can equate this term to this term. The adjacent length was ti, comma 1, divided by the hypotenuse is xi. Okay, so the xi's cross out, p1, I'll just put it out over here. The norm of p1 is equal to 1.0 by convention. We just define these vectors, these direction vectors, we define it to be unit vectors. So the magnitude. This is basically what this does, is it finds the magnitude of that vector. The magnitude of these direction vectors we set to be unit length. So P1 is equal to 1, the xi's cross out. So we're left with this formula that we had earlier. Ti1 is equal to xi transpose P. Okay? Now, let me just break this down a little bit. We've seen this in the last class, but I'll just go through here. Xi is the row from the X matrix over here. So there's K entries in that connection. So if you write Xi1, Xi2, Xi3, up to Xik, capital K. So that's vector X, times T, this is T1. So there's k entries in that p vector. Well, there's k entries in the p vector because that is a vector. P is that direction vector. It's in a k-dimensional coordinate system. We're in a k-dimensional coordinate system, so there must be k entries in p. This is very similar to the temperature example we had earlier. The temperature example, we said we had xi1 was the temperature measurement in the front left of the room. Xi2 was the temperature in the front left, front right. Xi3 was the temperature in the back left. Xi4 was the back right. And we multiplied that by 0.25. Remember, that was the temperature example we had earlier. And we said that was equal to the average temperature. So we get exactly the same looking system for in a general case. Okay. What I also want to just quickly talk about here regarding the temperature system is just look at this vector P. So I'll just call this P1 here. You know. Now P1, we said earlier on, needs to be a unit vector. If you look at this, we just put those coefficients in there. to say it's the average of the four temperatures, but it's not really a unit method. If you calculate P1, you'll find that that's equal to 0.5 rather than 1. So we can just rescale that, this vector. We can just simply say P1 is equal to 1 over the old magnitude of the vector times whatever its current magnitude is. That will give us a new vector, 0.5, 0.5, 0.5. So if I derived the temperature system correctly, my direction vector should have been 0.5, 0.5, 0.5, 0.5. This has unit length. This is more just an aside. I talk about this later on in the notes, so don't worry about this. I'm just pointing out that P1s for these direction vectors are by definition unit length, but we can scale them arbitrarily up and down. Okay. Now, just coming back to this system over here, I'd like to just talk a bit about the predictive ability of the PCA model. I said, remember, PCA finds this direction vector so that it best fits the data. What do I mean by that? We said that it means that this residual distance from the point to the direction vector is the smallest possible. So let's just talk a bit about this error vector over here for a second. When I look at this, I'll just redraw it over here so I don't clutter the diagram up. So we've got this vector going out to our observation. We're projected down at 90 degrees. So this P1 is a unit vector. And this distance over here we call our residual distance. But I just want to talk a bit about, if I take this vector and I find the projection onto the P1 direction, I'm actually finding a new point over here called xi hat. Call this xi hat, comma 1. This is the best prediction of x, of the original observation x. Because I've said that this component was found so that it best explains the data. That means I'm explaining the data and there's a residual left over after that. So when I'm saying I'm explaining the data, what I mean by that is I'm finding a new vector starting at the origin, going out to this point onto that vector P1. So this point over here is a vector called xi hat, comma 1. So it says it's the best prediction of the ith observation x using one or along the first component. Okay? Now, what is that vector equal to? How can I find this vector? Well, it's pretty easy to find it because we know that this vector P1 points in that direction already. So a vector is given by two quantities, the magnitude as well as the direction, recall. So when we say what is xi hat, we have to find the direction. We know what the direction is, xi hat, comma 1. The direction of xi hat is just equal to p1, the vector. But it's not, p1 is a unit vector. Xi hat isn't necessarily of unit length. So we just multiply it by that ti value. So just multiply it by ti1. That's a scalar, remember, scalar distance. So it just says we scale that vector up and down according to this length. Okay, so we'll see this coming up over and over, that the best prediction of xi1 is just equal to the small value ti times this direction vector p1. So that's what xi hat is for along the first component. We can also find xi hat along the second component. It's just, as you would expect, xi hat along the second component is going to be ti2, the distance along the second component. So if I construct the second component now, the second component is orthogonal to the first one. It's called P2. And I project this point down at 90 degrees. So this length over here is going to be TI2. So XI hat 2 is going to be TI2 times P2. And so XI hat for the third component is going to be TI3 P3, and so on, up to however many components we have in the system. So if I collect all of those together, can I erase this diagram over here now? I mean, what I'm looking for is a vector xi. We can show then that xi hat in general is equal to ti1, ti2. So all these distances along each component up to, we have A components. We'll use this notation capital A for the number of components, times the vectors P. P1, P2, P3, Pk. Or in general, we can write xi is equal to t, so we'll call this vector ti. So this vector here is a vector of 1 by a. That's a values of those scores. We just collect them all up and call that ti times, and when we collect all the p's together like this, we call that capital P. So we've got two equations now. We've got this equation that predicts the value of x. This point, x hat, is going to be on the plane. So for every data point, we're able to predict a projection onto that plane. That's the key point here, that it's a projection of the original value onto the plane is called x hat. We also know that the t's is equal to the rho from x. So we've got these two equations. This first one says, given a new vector x, we bring in a vector xi from our original matrix, we can do this one at a time. So take out a row from x, multiply it by p, the loadings matrix. This does is it finds those vectors t. Sorry, it finds the lengths t, t1 in for the ith value, t2 for the ith observation. So we basically get a vector here of those scores, the distances along each direction. Then we multiply that by p again. And then we get x hat, the predicted value of x. Okay? So these x hats are the locations on the plane that's defined by the components. And what we can then say is that residual vector, we can then go on to define the residual vector EI is equal to XI minus X hat. So this is a vector E, which says take your original vector, so take this original point up here that's sitting off the plane, subtract from it the best estimate of x, and that gives you that residual vector. Okay, so each of these are vectors. Okay, so let me just put here in pictorial form what we've got from all of this. Can I erase this over here now? Just so that there's a lot of equations flying around here, but it's not really that involved if you can see it directly to this one. So we've got our original X matrix over here with N rows and N columns. Okay. And we've said we can find also another X matrix, same size, called X hat, N by K. So this is a matrix of the same size as the original one, where x hat is the scores multiplied by the norm. Okay. So for each row in this data set, you know, we have an xi row. We can also get a row xi hat. And if we subtract these two from each other, we get another matrix called the error matrix, with n rows and k columns. So this basically what we're getting in this row here is a vector that goes from the model plane up to the actual data point. This is a vector that takes us from x, from the actual data point, to the projection onto the plane. And then just the final quantity that I'll introduce here, and then I think we've kind of introduced all the notation that we're going to use for today, and then the rest of the time I'll just talk about applications of this. We can introduce another quantity. If I consider this my residual distance, now this is my residual off the plane. Maybe I can illustrate it, but I'm not so great at drawing. So that's P1. P2 goes in the second direction over here. So these two vectors form a plane. And then if I imagine that I have a data point up here, this is my xi, okay? And I project this data point down onto that plane, okay? This is my xi hat. So take my original observation. I mean, I've got two components. Project it so that it lands on the plane. This vector over here, from the point on the plane back up to the original data point, that vector there is called EI. So that represents the three quantities we've got here on the board. XI represents the original data. XI hat is the best estimate of X on the plane. And then the EI represents the vector, the residual off the plane. Okay. Now, if we take a look at EI, it's a vector. It's a 1 by K vector as well. So we've got K columns. So EI, that's a 1 by K vector. Often what's also done is we take the sum of squares of the entry means. So we calculate a new single column. Okay, we call that SPE, the squared prediction error, which just says SPE is equal to, so SPE is equal to E. SPE for the I column is equal to EI transpose EI. That's just a fancy way of saying the sum of squares of the vector EI. And then you take the square root of that, because the distance is, you take the sum of squares and take the square root, gets you a distance. So SPE is the distance from the model plane up to the actual observation. And while I'm showing all these quantities pictorially, there's also, of course, a column here, the T1 column, and then another column called T2. Okay. So for each row in X, we get a corresponding X hat, we get a corresponding vector EI, we get a corresponding SPE value, as well as a T1 value and a T2 value. Okay? And that's what we're going to deal with today. We're going to look at plots of T1 versus T2, and that's what you need to look at in the third question in the take-on exam. Asks you to look at T1 versus T2. We're going to look at plots of SPE, we're going to look at plots of these vectors EI, and X hat is needed to get EI. Okay? So is there anything, we'll take a break for about 5-10 minutes, but before we do that, was there anything in that derivation that was unclear, or? So the rest of the class is going to be on just different applications of all of this. You're welcome to come ask me questions in the break now if there wasn't something to be quite there. Okay, so let's meet back in about 15 minutes. So we're back to this diagram here, and I just want to talk a bit about, we said we've got this column of numbers T1, we have another column of numbers T2. Just looking over here. We have a vector T1, we have a vector T2, we have a vector SPD. Now in this diagram, one way to see this is this plane. This plane given by the first and second component that's illustrated here with dashed lines. This forms a two-dimensional plane. We're in a three-dimensional coordinate system, or a k-dimensional coordinate system. But this plane, we're in a k-dimensional coordinate system. We've extracted a latent variables, or a components. A is in this case 2, k is 3. So those blue points, some are above the plane, above the orange plane, and some are below. Okay? So SPE is really a projection, SPE is the distance from each point onto the plane. It gives you the height of each point onto the plane. It's not clearly illustrated here, but you know, if those blue points are above and below the orange plane, SPE gives you the distance to the plane. Yeah.
Can you show us where P is on the plane?
Where the point projects onto the plane is x hat. Okay. Then, so remember we've got. So the point on the plane is x hat. The original point is x. So if I say take this point over here, the center of my coordinate system is over here. So this is the mean. That point is over here. And then there's some sort of plane, which I really can't draw this in 3D, so you're gonna have to work with me here. So there's xi. Okay. We project it down onto the plane and we say land up at that point. That point is xi hat. That vector E is that vector over there. Because remember we said EI is XI minus XI hat. So these are all three vectors. So just using vector addition or subtraction, XI minus XI hat. So here's our origin. That vector over there is XI hat. The vector from the origin to XI. And then the vector difference between that xi hat and xi is your residual E. Okay. And then SPE is the sum of squares inside. So we just take E as a vector, a row vector, we just take the sum of squares within that vector, we get an SPE value, which represents the distance of the model plane. Okay. So what we've done here is we're in a three-dimensional world. Every data point here has coordinates x1, x2, x3. Okay, those are the original coordinates. When we project those points onto the plane, we get a new set of coordinates. Okay, so let me put it this way. You start off with matrix x. For each row in x, it gives us the locations of the blue points in the diagram. So it says, for the I point, the first element is at x1, second element is at x2, the third element is at x3. So it gives me the location in this three-dimensional coordinate system for each of the blue points. Now imagine I project all those blue points onto the plane. So every single one of them collapses onto the plane. Those points are now called x hat. Okay? I get a new set of coordinates which just represent the projection of each point onto the plane. We call that matrix x hat. Okay? So that's the difference between x and x hat. Now, one thing that's going to require some imagination on your side is we're going to now move from this three-dimensional world to a two-dimensional world. We're going to take this plane and bring it forward out to you, and we're going to only focus on this plane. We're going to plot, basically, in all the next things coming up, we're going to reorient ourselves to look at this plane straight on. So we're going to be looking at this plane this way. This is going to be our first component, and this is going to be our second component. We're going to look at the projection of all these data points onto the plane, and mentally, there's going to be a residual distance, the SPE, forwards and backwards. Some are going to be below, into the board, and some are going to be out of the board. We're going to reorient ourselves, our view, to just this two-dimensional board. So one way that this is often described, I like the analogy, is you can consider this like a television monitor or a computer screen. When you watch a video online or TV, you're watching a 2D representation of a 3D world. Okay? So there's a third dimension which you're unable to quantify on the television screen, but you can infer from the TV. This is going to be the same thing. We've got a 3D world, these points move in a 3D space. We're only going to look at their projections onto that plane, okay? In the next part of this class today. Okay, so all these concepts kind of coming together. Okay, so let's take a look at an example. So this example is on page 18 of your notes. And it's a set of data from food confirmation. It's a set of data from a food manufacturer where there's five measurements taken on each observation. We measure five attributes on these patients. So we measure the percentage oil, that would be the first column of numbers, the density, the crispiness, which has got a number from 7, so 7 is not very crispy, right up to 15 is very crispy. We measure the angle, the fracture angle. So this is, if you take the pastry and you start to bend it, the fracture angle is the angle at which the pastry cracks. Okay, so it's a number, say, between 10 and 30 degrees. So a 10 would be that it cracks with almost very little change, and then a 13-degree fracture angle says you have to really bend it a lot before it changes. And then hardness. So this is a sharp point that's driven into the pastry or into this biscuit-type food. And it's the force required by this point before this biscuit shatters apart or breaks apart. Okay? So there's these last three properties are kind of taste measurements. We call them organoleptic properties. If you're working in the food industry, you'll hear this all the time. These are the organoleptic properties of the product. So the crispiness, the fracture angle would kind of be a measure of how, basically when you're biting it in your teeth, it's going to give you that same impression of by how much do you have to bend it before it breaks. And then the hardness is the force required. So you poke it with a sharp object and before it shatters apart. So we get these five measurements. And it's helpful if you've got page 19 printed out pretty big on full size to take a look at all the data in one go. Okay, so this is called a scatter plot matrix. For each of the variables we show its scatter plot with the other four variables. So let's take a look at oil versus density. So this is a scatter plot of oil on the y-axis. So the oil values range between 14% oil up to 20% oil. And versus density on the x-axis, which is 2,600 to 3,000. So the correlation between oil and density is a negative correlation. In general, as oil level is high, the density is low. And for pastries where the oil level is at the lower end, so 14% oil, the density tends to be higher. So the more oily the pastry, the less density seems to be. Okay? For whatever physical reason, we're not sure of the physical phenomenon that caused this relationship, we're just recording the correlations here. The relationship between oil and crispiness is a positive correlation. The more oily the pastry, the more crispy. And then there seems to be a somewhat negative correlation between oil and the fracture angle. So the fracture angles go from 10 degrees to about 32, 33 degrees. So a more oily pastry, so a higher oil value would be up here, would have a short, a narrower or a smaller angle through which you have to bend it before it breaks. And then there doesn't seem to be much relationship to hardness and the oil. So that's just the relationship between oil and the other four minerals. And we can go through these others. For example, there seems to be a good negative correlation between the fracture angle and the crispiness. So hot pastries which are very crispy, they have a small fracture angle. And that makes sense. Something that's very crispy, it doesn't take a big angle before it starts to break apart. Whereas the less crispy pastries, they have to be bent through a much greater angle before they break. Now, hardness kind of, if you just look at this row of plots here, shows the relationship between hardness on the y-axis versus the other four variables. And there doesn't seem to be much relationship between hardness and anything else. Hardness kind of seems to be what we'll call an independent measurement. It's not correlated with anything else. It's independent. All the other plots in the scatter plot matrix, the relationship between oil density, oil and crispiness, density and crispiness, all of these tend to have some sort of correlation. A strong positive, a strong negative correlation, or at least a weak positive or weak negative correlation, but there's something there. Whereas apart from maybe like some sort of crispiness correlation, that's a little bit all over that over there. So it's hard to say. So I like this example because we're going to see these correlations in the loadings plots and in the score plots and so on. This allows you to come back to the raw data and verify that when you're interpreting a loadings plot or the score plot, you can then look back at the original data and see whether your interpretation matches. Whereas with a bigger data set, it would be impossible to do that. So this is a nice one to get going. But we're not breaking any boundaries here. We're saying k is equal to 5. We'll see how there's two components in the system. It's not, you could look at this data univariately or just like this and get a good appreciation for it. But in general, PCA will work when k is much, much larger. So this is just a good way to get going. Okay, so the first step with PCA is to center and scale your raw data. You don't almost never work on the untreated data. You take your raw data that you get from your lab, and there's almost always a pre-processing step. And I'll just talk about centering and scaling here. But in the notes, there's a longer discussion on it, and we're not going to cover it in the course. But it's on page 28. I talk about transformations and centering and scaling and outliers and adding extra columns to X. Those are additional forms of pre-processing. But we're only going to look at centering and scaling in this class. But when I'm going to look at the other classes in April, for the SET students and for the other students that are interested, we'll look at other sorts of transformations you can make to the data and other types of pre-processing. But for now, we really will just focus on centering and scaling because this is done every data set I've worked on. I've always pretty much centered and scaled or done some form of centering and scaling. Okay, enough of that. So let's take a look at the raw data over here on the left-hand side. That is a box plot of the raw data. So five variables. Each one of them can be shown as a box plot. And because there's such difference in units, particularly the densities measured in the 3,000 odd range, all the other variables are lower numbers, this box plot is distorted. Okay? So that's the raw data. If we mean center it, as I've said before, we take for the kth column in X, we subtract the mean. The mean is calculated from that raw data, so we subtract the mean from every entry in that column, and we get a new vector called x-centered. If I plot the x-centered variable for every one of the five variables, I get the second box plot over there. So that's just centered. I've pulled everything out to be roughly with the mean of zero. Well, actually, not roughly, it is. The mean will be exactly zero. If you recalculate the mean of this matrix, it's going to be at a mean of zero. If you subtract the mean, the mean afterwards will be zero. So centering just brings you to that, the center point of the coordinate system. Scaling then gets rid of the units. For example, if you measure kilograms or grams, your denominator here will be the same units as your numerator. Your denominator, in this particular example, I've scaled using the standard deviation. And that's the most common way to scale your data. You divide through by the standard deviation of that column. You can, it doesn't matter here, I calculate the standard deviation on the centered vector, but if you calculate the standard deviation on the raw vector, you're going to get exactly the same number. Because remember, the definition for standard deviation is the sum of xi minus x bar, so, or squared, okay, divided by n minus 1. So whether you use the raw data here or the ridge or the centered vector, it doesn't matter. You get your scaling vector, your scale data. Now, if you calculate the variance of every column in that matrix x, it will have unit variance. So every column in x now, we've gone from this case with x, I'll call this x raw. We've gone from x raw to x. If I calculate the mean of x, I calculate a vector containing the mean, that vector is going to be zeros. If I calculate the standard deviation or the variance, doesn't matter which, that vector is going to be 1. So after centering and scaling, the mean is 0, standard deviation is 1. Oh, no, that's fine. If you divide it through, you've taken each column here. You calculate the standard deviation of that column, and you divide through, and you get a new vector x, you get a, its standard deviation after scaling is 1. You can write it out tediously mathematically, and you can prove it, but it's, or you just plug it into your computer and check it. Now, you don't have to use the standard deviation. You can use the median absolute deviation. You don't have to use the mean. You can use the median. You can use any suitable estimate of the center or any suitable estimate of variance or standard deviation. And often we do use the median because, see how that's calculated on the raw data. If your raw data has lots of outliers, that mean is going to be biased. So you could replace it with the median. You could replace that with the MAD, but we often don't. We just leave it like that because when we start looking at the data after this, when we start doing the principal components and so on, we're going to find the outliers anyway. So we often don't bother too much. We just use the mean, we use the standard deviation. And this is so common that we call, there's a name for this, it's called auto-scaling. So if you auto-scale your data, it has mean of 0 and unit variance. The important thing is that by doing this, you don't change any of the relationships between the variables. The correlation structure between the x's before and afterwards is the same. This does nothing. This just improves the numerical capabilities of the algorithm, and it also gets rid of this offset. And we do this because often the mean is not that interesting to us. We know where the mean of our process is, and we can always go undo this afterwards if we want to get back to the real world units. So PCA, when you plug your PCA, when you do PCA on your computer, it never works on the raw data. We'll always first do this pre-processing step, get a matrix X, and that's what we send to the algorithm to calculate the principal components. We don't use the raw data. So I illustrated over there on the far right-hand side what the box plot looks like after centering and after scaling. The mean is zero. Remember, the box plots show the median. They don't show the mean. That's why those lines don't always land up at zero. And the size of the box, if I had used the standard deviation, the size of that box would be exactly at plus or minus 1. But I've used the box plot in R uses the median absolute, or interquartile range, in fact. So it's not going to be exactly. But the point is that you see your data now is all consistent. And you can now compare things like oil, which was measured in units of percentage, and density, which was measured in whatever units, and crispy, and fracture, and hardness of these arbitrary measurements, they can now all be fairly compared. Okay, now is the first component, P1. So we're in a five-dimensional space here. K is equal to 5. What P1 is showing is the direction vector, which explains the greatest source of variation. Okay? And if I write it out numerically, remember P1 has to be a unit vector. The magnitude of P1 is 1. But these are the coefficients or weights in P1. Now, it may not mean anything to you right now, but let's take a look at what how you should interpret this. Remember that we said the t values, the scores, they're linear combinations of the p's. So we take our raw data, we center and scale it, so now we get the center and scale x. And for each row in x, we get this equation that ti is equal to, and I'm just going to look at the first component, so this would be ti1. Ti is equal to xip. So the t's are given by the linear combination of the x's, so this vector x, a linear combination of that x given by the weights in p. So when we're finding that first component that best explains the data, the score values are calculated by saying the first weight in P, so let's write this out. So X, I'm going to drop the I subscript. We'll just deal with the I observation here. So X1, we take, or X oil in this case, times P1 oil. So that's the weight for oil in the first component, 0.46. So plus X times density times P1 for density plus, and so on. I go to X crispy times its weight, P crispy, plus the same for the fracture angle, the same for the hardness. So T1 is a summation of five values. The X oil times its weight, the density times its weight, crispy, and so on for fraction, and so on for hardness. So here I've written about taking these coefficients, P multiplied by X oil, X density. So let's take a look at, remember X oil is the centered and scaled value, not the raw data. Okay? We take the actual oil measurement, which was, say, a number between 14 and 20, we subtract off the mean, and then we divide it by the standard deviation. Remember from those box plots up there, what that means is that after we centered and scaled, oil values are numbers that go between minus 2 and plus 2. In fact, all the data pretty much, after centering and scaling, each of the x's has a numeric value that's roughly between minus 2 and plus 2. Say minus 3 and plus 3, if there's some kind of bias. So these x's over here are numbers that are ranged between minus 2 and plus 2. So if we get a high T1 value, a high T1 value means, what does that mean? To get a large positive T1, what would you have to do? What would your x look like for oil? A positive oil. So you have to have an oil value that's above average. To get a high T1, what would a density look like? Negative. So you have to have a negative times a negative gives you a positive. So you get a positive coefficient here plus a positive coefficient here implies density has to be below average. The crispiness has to be above average in order to get a high T1. The fracture angle below average, so that means a small fracture angle, you can't bend it very much without breaking. And hardness times 0.15. So So how would we describe a pastry with a high T1 value? What would be the characteristics of a pastry with high T1? So it would be oily, crispy. It would be, you don't have to bend it very much to break. So it sounds like it's going to be crispy. You don't have to bend it very much. It's fairly brittle. It's got low density, so it's light. So you can kind of start to characterize what a high T1 means. It's a light, fluffy pastry, easy to break, and very crispy. And a low T1 pastry would be the opposite. It's, to get a negative T1 or a low T1, you'd have to have a below average oil. So a negative oil, a high density value, so a very oily, dense pastry, not very crispy at all. So it's almost very soggy and moist, perhaps oily. What would the fracture angle have to be? You'd have to have a large fracture angle. So this means you can bend this pastry quite a bit before it breaks. And hardness times 0.15. Hardness doesn't seem to have much effect in this component. So that's the other interesting thing. Hardness has almost no effect in this component. So if we go look back at this scatterplot matrix, we saw here originally that hardness has almost no correlation to any of the other measurements. All these other measurements, though, are heavily weighted in the first component. It would imply then that the first component is really explaining all this data up here in the first four rows and the first four columns. Is what the first component is summarizing all those correlations with each other in one component. And then the hardness seems to be independent of the rest of it. So let's see if that's true. Before we do that though, I'd like to just work through an actual numerical example. Let's take a look at sample 33. So this is sample 33 over here. If I've got the T1 values, in time, in sequence order. So here we had said these T1 values here, those would be soft and soggy pastries, and these would be maybe more crispy. 33 is this large negative over here. So you've kind of already got a feeling for the batch of pastries at batch number 33 would like. But let's go take a look. Go look back at the scatterplot matrix and find, or mark the point on the scatterplot matrix that has, that you think would be sample 33. So page 19. And locate on that plot the point that you would think is sample 33. Anyone kind of figured it out with 33 would be? Also, you could, I don't know, perhaps I'll just do it. that one. Okay, so oil is 15.5. So it's somewhere on this low end of oil. Which cost reference of density is 3125. So it's one of those over here. Let's see if we can isolate it further using the Christie value. It's 7. So yeah, here Christie goes from about 7 to 15 on this axis, so it's definitely that bottom point over here. So it's, given that's Christie, we can just infer that, okay, so it's that point over there. That would be point 33. Its fracture has got to be high. Its fracture is about 33. Yep. And then hardness is around 92. Okay, so it's pretty much that point that's on the edge over there. So, recalling then that that's a pastry with a negative T1 value, what would you say those pastries up there would be? Like in this region, what would you say the pastries up there would be? What kind of T1 would they have? High T1. So if we go look back at the loadings plot with T1 in terms of oil, oil is a positive loading. Okay? So to get a high T1 value, you need a high amount of oil in your pastry. So those points up there would have high T1s, high levels of oil. Then those at the lower end would have negative T1 values. Okay, is that clear? Let's take a look at density. We just stick to that plot over there. Density had a negative weight in the first component of negative 0.47. So to get a high T1, you said we needed a low density. And that matches exactly with that plot. So high oil, low density, low oil, high density. So negative T1 means the operating at high density. And you can go then through the other variables as well. Let's just quickly do that for crispiness. I'll use this plot over here, the relationship between, this one here, crispy and fracture. Let's just use this kind of plot here. So crispy had positive weight, and fracture had a negative weight. So a high T1 means very crispy, and a small fracture angle. So you bend it very little and it breaks. So high crispy, low fracture. That's confirmed then, so high crispy, low fracture, that would be high T1 over here, and low T1 would be over here. So this is actually quite nice because we've got one single plot here, this loadings plot over here. These five fairly simple looking coefficients that capture, in this particular example, they capture 61% of the variation in the whole data set. You can understand then, of all these five columns, 61% of the variation in all five columns can be understood with just a single component. This one over here. So if you've got this, if you understand this then, it's very easy to infer how your process moves. If you are making these pastries and your boss asked you to make a pastry that's got low oil and high crispiness, could you do that? You've got no evidence, like low oil and high crispiness, you've got no evidence to say that we've manufactured that in the past. Always, your oil is low and your crispiness is low, and then when oil is high, crispiness is high. There may be a particular combination of settings on your process that does give you a low oily pastry, still retaining its crispiness, but it's certainly not in your historical data. In these past data, it might be possible, we're not saying it can't be done, but given this data set, maybe this data set represents the past 2-3 years of randomly selected batches from your process. Certainly in this data set, there's no observation that meets those criteria. You can see that just with this loading spot. You can see that when oil is high, crispiness is high. Those two variables go together. You can't change them independently of each other. So again, when I said at the start of this class, we have to start thinking multivariately. You might think that your boss says, make a low oily pastry. Well, I'm just going to then reduce the amount of oil I add to the recipe. but it's not a univariate change, it's a multivariate change. You're also going to affect all these other variables. If you reduce oil, your crispiness will go down as well. Your density probably will go higher, and your fracturing will go higher. All these things will move together, okay, to be consistent with each other. That certainly should the case for at least the majority of the variation in your data shows that they obey that relationship between each other. So this is why it's sometimes a little bit hard to wrap your head around that, yeah, you think I can go and adjust oil independently, but yes, you can, you're making an independent adjustment, but several other variables will move with it. In the case of, say, the distillation columns, where you're increasing the steam flow to your reboiler, you're making one change, but it's affecting multiple variables. Your temperatures are all going to start moving up, the impurity coming out the column is going to change. So, yes, you make a univariate change, but it has a multivariate effect. In this case, one of the five variables happens to be one that you can manipulate. You can manipulate oil. You can't really, at least directly, manipulate density, crispiness, fracturing, and hardness. Those come about from the way you cook the pastry or other process conditions that we don't have in our data set. Oil is the only one we can manipulate. When you make that high, crispiness is also high, density is low, fracture is low, and hardness doesn't really move too much. So this is a great way to summarize the relationships in the data set, is by looking at the loadings plot. In fact, whenever I look at any new data set for the first time, I spend at least a good hour or so investigating the loadings plot, looking at different relationships amongst the variables. I see this, that okay, oil and crispiness seem to be correlated together with each other. They've both got positive weights. That means they move up and down together. So when I see that in a loadings plot, between, say, any two variables, I then go back to the raw data, oil and crispiness, and I verify that I see that relationship in the raw data as well. Or, for example, here I see that crispiness and fracture move opposite each other. I can't change them independently, or I see that they're, at least they're negatively correlated. When crispiness is high, fracture is low. So we go back to our scatter plot and verify. Sure enough, there's that negative correlation between crispiness and fracture. So when you, the first thing I do when I look at a data set the first time is I spend quite some time on the loadings plot examining P1, and I see, okay, these variables are positively correlated, or they're negatively correlated, or they have no correlation with each other. So again, coming back to the first component, fracture and hardness don't seem to be related. I mean, in fact, hardness doesn't seem to be related with any of the variables. That's why it's got a long way. And then with this bottom row in the scatter plot matrix, you can confirm all those relationships. So that's a really nice way to visualize your data by looking at the loading plot. So let's take a look now at, I just want to talk a bit about the scores. So T1 had a value of minus 4.2. And we've seen here where I started to write out that T1 is a linear combination of the data x given by the weights in P. So let's go verify that, just at least for one calculation. So that's the equation. It says T1 value for observation, for any observation, is 0.46 times the oil and minus 0.47 times the density and so on. So let's go plug in the raw data. So you can go do this for yourself. The vector of means and centering is, I think it's on page 17 or 18 of your notes. It's that little table over there that gives you the mean and standard deviation. So you can then go take the raw data. So oil for observation 33 had a value of 15.5%. The mean for column, for the oil column, was 17.2. That's recorded in the notes there. And the standard deviation in the raw data set was 1.59. So this data is on the course website. I've just made a printout here for it. But you can go try this later on yourself to duplicate the scores. You take your raw data value, subtract the mean, and divide through by the standard deviation. You do that for each of the x variables. So for each of oil, density, crispiness, fracture, and hardness, you would then calculate the centered and scaled values. This is just for observation 33, right? So you could go do this for all the, I think there's 50 observations in this data set. So I'm just showing you the procedure for one observation. So subtract the mean, divide it by the standard deviation, you get your centered and scaled x. Then you multiply these values through by those loadings. So remember we said that t is equal to xp. So ti for observation 33 is equal to the xi value centered and scaled times p1. So it's a linear combination of the x is given by the p's. So if you say minus 1.07 times 0.46, 2.15 minus 0.47. So this says here, this is this observation 33 has above average density, below average crispness, above average fracture angle. That's how you would infer those centered scale numbers. Is that clear? Yeah. And then you calculate the T1, and you'll confirm then that you can get, so if you just substitute that all in, calculate that out, you would get the minus 4.2 number over there. This is for observation 33. And that's what's shown on page 21 in the notes. If you look at the score plot, I show the scores, the T1 values for each observation. Observation 33 is that negative value of minus 4.2. Okay. So why is, we've quantified what a low T1 means. A low T1 means that it's a pastry that's got high amounts of oil. A negative T1 means it's got low amounts of oil, high density. So low amounts of oil, high density, you see that's above average. Below average crispness, yes, the crispness is below average, it's 7 compared to the mean of 11.5. It's got an above average fracture angle, plus 33 minus 20, and then the hardness. So when we take these five terms and we multiply them up like that, we're summing five pieces. We can write them up this way. So we write T1 is then, we're just adding these five separate pieces. We can see which variables contribute the most to causing this low T1 value. Okay? So here it's clear that the reason why this pastry is in where it is, got this very low T1 value, is because, mainly because of these three variables. And these variables contribute the most to causing that negative T1. It seems to be the density, the crispness, and the fracture angle that cause a low T1 value. Okay? Previously, just to come back here, when I looked at this plot originally, just the loading spot for P1, I could say, well, to get a low T1 value, I need what from the oil? How would I get a low T1? What would the oil have to be? Below average density, above average crispiness, below average fracture angle, above average, and hardness, it doesn't really matter. But which one of the four is it? Is it one of the four, or is it two of the four, or all of the four that I need? Like, how much do I need from each one in order to get that negative T1 value? The thing is, when you look at the loading spot, it's a generalization, saying, in general, to get a negative T1, or a very soggy, poor pastry, you would need to offer these four factors. But because it's a linear combination, it's a summation of four different terms. I'm dropping my hardness. Hardness doesn't have much effect. So it's a summation of oil, density, crispiness, and fracture. Those four combined in some way gives me a negative T1. But I'm not sure how much do I need from each one. Or let's turn it around the other way. This is, when I was just speaking here, I'm saying in general to get a low T1, this is what I need you to do. For example, say your boss said, I need you to manufacture a pastry that has these properties, where the oil is high, density is low, crispiness is high, fracture is low. You say, great, I've done it before. We just go and move our process to operate in this region where we got these pastries here previously. We go back and look at our records on such and such a date. We got a low T1 value by operating the process at these conditions. Okay, so that's a kind of a what if analysis. But the other way to look at it is, we've got this negative T1 value. What caused this specific batch to have that negative value? Was it due to the oil? Was it due to the density? Was it due to the crispy or the fracture? Well, we're not sure. It's some combination of the four. So when we're looking at the way we find out which variables it's due to, we write out T1, but just before we sum them all up, we stop and we take a look at the five individual contributions. So there's a contribution from each variable. And in fact, we'll show later on, you can just plot these as a bar chart. You just show this coefficient on a bar plot. So you have a bar plot of five columns, one for each column of K, and we call that a contribution plot. Okay? So it shows how much each variable contributes to causing a given T1 value. Okay, so let's just take a 5-minute break. I think you just need to stretch your legs a bit, and then we'll go on and I'll demonstrate this in a different way. Look at observation 36. So observation 36 is creating IT1 value. And you can go and look on the scatter plot and try to estimate what observation 36 would be. So if I just rewrite some of this now for observation 36. So using the same process, find for on the scatter plot what 36 would look like. It has an oil value of 21.1, 2570 for the density, the crispiness is 14, fracture angle is 13, and the hardness for observation 36 is 1.5. Okay, so just cross reference the scatter plot for that. So we won't calculate it by hand. We'll just say it is 3.6. We've just done it in the same way. So if we go, I'll just go work through this one here. So an observation where the oil is high, 21.1. It's pretty much the extreme over here. High oil and density was 2570, which is low, the very low end. Crispiness is 14, so the high level of crispiness is over here. Low fracture is 13, so 13 is down here. So it's pretty much this point on the other extreme. So 36 is a point with high T1, 33 was a point down here, low T1. So we can kind of see this vector T1 as modeling the extremes along this correlation pattern. Those points up here would have high T1, these points would have low T1. These points up here with high crispiness. So high crispiness is associated with high values of T1. So these would be high T1 observations, low T1 observations. As was raised here during the break, is how do you interpret this T1 value? Like some values are say -3, some are +3. Well, it depends on the data set you're dealing with, and it depends on the loadings that define that direction. But it could be conceptually that negative T1 represents an undesirable product, and IT1s represent a more desirable product. So in that sense, once you've got your five raw values, you've run a new batch of pastries. At the end, you send it to your lab. So here's X. You get this new set of measurements, X mu, from the lab for a new batch of pastries with five values. Your mean center and scale using this, these equations over here. You get your X. So we'll call this X in your raw. That's your raw data. After centering and scaling this, we get a vector which is called X mu with five values. Then you multiply that X mu. You say T1 mu equals X mu times P1. Okay? And that will give you your corresponding T1 value for that batch of pastries. That T1 value then might be 0, which says it's somewhere here in the middle of poor quality and high quality. Like these pastries here might be sold at a premium price, whereas these over here at very low T1, they may be too soft or too soggy and you have to scrap that batch. So that's one way you can interpret T1. For this specific example, you might be able to come up with a meaning for T1 that means something to you in terms of that you can quantify or use in some way. It doesn't work in every data set that you look at. And it very much depends on what your interpretation of P1 is. And in other data sets, what often happens is that P1 is uninteresting, but P2 is more interesting. And then P2 is where you find a good interpretation. For example, with this data set, let's take a look at P2. The second vector is something like this. So it's got pretty low coefficients for the four variables. Some coefficients for oil and density. But hardness is definitely the predominant direction in the second component. So a high T2 value, how would you interpret a high T2 value? What would be the characteristics of a pastry with high T2? A hard pastry, yeah. And then, so the hardness was that measurement where we stuck a sharp object into it and it was the force required. So that could be kind of simulating how a tooth breaks or bites into a pastry. These are organoleptic properties. So we're trying to simulate what the human mouth would be, those properties, texture properties in the human mouth bites using these lab measurements. So hardness represents what your mouth feel is based on when you bite into the pastry. So this T2 direction, or P2 direction, explains 26% of the variation in the data set. So coming back, we've got two components. We've taken our X matrix, which had five columns, K equals five, and we've now simplified it down to a T1 and a T2 vector. T1 explains 61%, T2 explains 26%. So jointly we've explained, 87% of the data variation, just with two components. Okay. Another way to see this is that when you've measured these five variables in the lab, they're not measuring five different independent properties of the pastry. They are measuring five properties of the pastry, five different properties that you can talk about to your colleagues. This pastry was harder than that one. This pastry had more fracture angle than the other. But in terms of the multivariate space in which these numbers move, there's only two dimensions. You cannot move in this plane along which the points project onto move in a two-dimensional world. Even though you take five measurements, there's really only two directions in which one can move on that plane. You can have a high T1 and a high T2 value, and a low T1 and a low T2 value, and you could be in any quadrant of T1 and T2. In fact, let's just take a look at that now. Here, so here I'm showing on the left-hand side, T1 on the horizontal axis and T2 on the vertical axis. Okay? So here's pastry 33 out here with very low T1. And its T2 value is approximately, given the range, we can just say around it to zero. So it's neither very hard nor very soft.
Okay,
but we know it's very soggy. So this general direction from left to right gives you a feeling of the crispiness or the fragility of the pastry. So pastries are high T1, have a high oil, high crispiness, they're more flaky perhaps. Pastries over here have low oil, they're more dense, you can bend them quite a lot more before they break. So it gives you a general feeling of how the data move from left to right in that space. And you only have to consider this space. You don't have to look at a five-dimensional plot or five dimensions, five separate variables. You only have to look at this two-dimensional world to get a pretty complete picture of how everything is moving in this system. If you look at the loadings plot, this shows those same relationships we saw there earlier, but this is also a great way to interpret the model. That big scatter plot matrix we saw earlier with the 25 different scatter plots in them can be summarized just with this single plot over here. Let's take a look. So we saw that crispiness was negatively correlated with density. So if you go back to your page 19, the scatter plot matrix, and you look at crispiness versus density, you'll see that there's a negative relationship between crispiness and density. You see that over here. They're oppositely correlated to each other. Oil and density also have a negative correlation. So if you look at the oil versus density scatter plot, that's the one in the first row of the second column, it's got a negative correlation between oil and density, and we see that over here. So density is up here, the oil is down there. They're oppositely correlated to each other. When oil goes a high, the density of the pastry goes down. Similar, the relationship between crispiness and fracture. If you look at that scatter plot, so that's in the third row and the fourth column. It shows a negative correlation. As the pastry is more crispy, the angle through which it fractures is a smaller angle. That makes sense. A very crisp pastry cannot be bent a lot before it starts to shatter. So as crispiness is high, the crispy scale goes from 7 to 15. So a very crisp pastry has a very small fracture angle. Okay. And then this shows how hardness moves almost independently of the other two. Okay. So one way to take a look at that is when I was working on these notes over the weekend, I just decided to do this little piece of software to kind of illustrate the principle. Okay, so here's the score plot, the same score plot that we had there earlier. I just moved to a different software, so it looks a little bit different. But for example, here's page 333. And page 336 was up here with a high T on that. Now, what's going to happen here is this red point is a new score. I'm bringing in a new observation, X nu. And I'm going to show you what the glands on the score plot. That red point in the middle is the score value that you get when oil is at 17.2, density is 2857. This is actually, if you look at these values, these are the mean. So if you look at page 20 of the notes, I've recorded what the mean of each column was. Okay, so that makes sense. If you bring in X and U, that's exactly where every variable is at the mean. The mean minus the mean is a zero. So the sentiment scale value for X is going to be zero. And then when you say T1 mu is equal to X mu times P1. So that's saying a zero vector, doesn't matter what you multiply with, your T1 value is going to be zero also. So the point, and this makes intuitive sense, when I showed that geometric that cloud of points at the start of the class, I showed how we mean center the data, then the mean lands up at the center of the coordinate system. That's exactly what this is showing, is that any point that's at the mean when you multiply by P1, 0 times P1, your T1 value is 0. Same for T2u is equal to xu times P2. So the T2 value is also at the center of the coordinates. Okay, so now let's take a look at oil. If I move oil, remember oil has a positive positive weight on the first loading. So we just plot out the first loading here as P1. Oil was high, and then density was negative. And then the third one was crispy. And the fourth one was in fracture. And the fifth one was, this is pretty small refinement, right? Okay, so if we move oil up and down, which way do you expect it to move if I move oil, if I increase the oil content of the pastry, which way do you expect that observation to go? Okay, so, the way you expect it. It makes, if you look back at the loading spot over here, so oil is loaded in the loading spot, it's down over here. If I increase, if I'm starting at the center and I increase the oil just by itself, it's going to head off. These points over here have high quantities of oil. So I like to superimpose the loading spot and the scatter plot side by side, or mentally you can superimpose them, because these observations down here will have high oil and low density. So another way that I can move in this direction is by decreasing the density. So let's take a look. So I've increased the oil, and I move in that direction. Another way you can do that is by decreasing the density and also moving in that direction. Okay. Now, so let me just reset this back to the center. If I wanted to increase, say I wanted to get to where patient 33 is, I would increase the fracture and I would decrease the crispy. So increase the fracture and decrease the crispiness would get you to that. Now notice, of course, in reality you can't manipulate these measurements, but I'm just saying, what if, or what does it take to get an observation down here? You would need to set the settings on your process so that you get less crisp product with greater fracture ability. And as we said, hardness is independent of the other three. If I go and move hardness, it moves up and down along that direction. Okay. So this is just illustrating this principle. You bring in a new x, you calculate the T1 and T2. It also illustrates how to interpret this loading plot. Points which are diagonally opposite each other, diagonally through the origin. So if you go through the origin, these points are negatively correlated with each other. When oil is high, density is low. So a pastry up here, patient 22, has high density and low oil. A patient 21 has even greater density and even lower oil still than 22. Okay. Now, there's a third factor that's going on here in the system that is the distance off the plane. Okay. We're kind of just looking at this two-dimensional world, but we're in a five-dimensional world. Remember, the coordinate system we're dealing with is actually a five-dimensional coordinate system for each of the five variables. We're just looking at a 2D plane that's embedded inside this 5D world. The SPE, then, is the distance from this plane to wherever the actual data is. Now, you may have noticed up here at the top, I'm pointing out what the SPE is. And the reason for doing that is when I move a point around like this, you see how SPE goes up and up? It's because as I move this point just by itself, it's becoming less and it's moving further and further off the plane. This is the important thing, I cannot independently go move one variable at a time. Multivariately, it comes to that idea where your boss says, make me a pastry that's got low oiliness. Remember, we want a pastry that's low oil or low fat, but still crispy. If I try to move a page to low oil and high crispiness, you see how my SPE value has shot up? It just keeps it get the 95% limit for SPE for the data is about 1.2. So a value of 3.6 says I've got this model plane. So now you've got your plane over here, this 2D plane. Okay. Now we're in a 5D coordinate system, but I'm just showing you here in three dimensions. This is your plane. Each point is above or below the plane. Okay, so that's the distance above. That point is on the plane. This point is above the plane. There's a point above the plane here. This point's below the plane. You can establish what is a typical residual distance. We can calculate a 95% confidence interval for a typical residual. So the stuff like R and so on can do this for you. In this particular example, this distance from the plane that which captures 95% of the points is about 1.2. So an SPE of 3.67 is far off the plane. It's showing you that you cannot just arbitrarily go and shift the oil to a low-fat pastry and still get it crispy at the same time. It's just not in your, it's just not possible, but at least historically, you've never operated the process so that you can achieve that sort of quality in your final product. Okay? So that, it may be a little bit going a bit beyond where PCA and so on is normally taught, this being only the second time you've seen it, but I want you to at least start to think that there is this plane, the latent variable plane, embedded inside your k-dimensional space, or in this case, five-dimensional space, and you are constrained to moving on that plane. You can't just arbitrarily move your points around off that plane. And when we look at score plots like this, it's showing you the projection of the actual data onto that plane. What you're seeing in that score plot over there is where these individual observations just collapse onto the plane. Some points might be far off the plane, like if I had to plot SPE going in and out the board, point 36 might be far, far back, but it's still projecting into the plane. For example, point 45 could be have a very high SPE. It could be out here, but I'm just seeing the projection onto the T1, T2 plane over here. Okay, so that's the that little software tool here just kind of illustrates a bit about the movement, and it validates what we interpreted here in this combination plot. So this is very common when you're looking at a new data set for the first time to put up the score plot and the loadings plot, and you kind of interrogate the two simultaneously. And I always like to go back to the raw data to verify my findings. Okay, so I'm just going to move on here now to the next section on interpreting the score plots. We've already interpreted them, but I'm just going to talk a bit about some other concepts. So when we plot score plots, we either plot them in time sequence or we plot them in scatter plots. So T1 versus T2 or T3 versus T2. Or we can just plot them in time order. So just plot T1 in time. And we look for patterns in the data, like clusters. So here's a good example. This was one of the early applications of PCA in chemical engineering. This was back in 1991. This lady did her master's with John McGregor. She was looking at FCC process from a refinery in Montreal. I think there was in the order of 150 variables. So K equal to 150. And this is the two-dimensional plot. So it's a 2D summary in 150 dimensions. So the center point is over here. Here's the center of the model. Observation landing right there would be exactly at the mean of the process conditions. So this illustrates quite nicely how the refinery is moving. The majority of the operation is in this region A. Then the process shifts over to region B, and then it comes back down to region C. These other clusters, it didn't pass through this cluster. This cluster would be region E, F, and G. In her thesis, she has several sequential plots that show these different clusters. So the process starts in A, then moves to B, then down to C. Now this is the score plot. How would you find out why did the process move from A to B? How could you figure it out? If you saw this score plot, what would be your next step to go take a look at to figure out why the process moved from region A to region B? P2. Yeah, exactly. So the movement is in the T2 direction. So you would then go look at the loading vector for P2 and find out which variables have large positive and large negative weights in P2. A variable that has a large P2 weight means that that variable increased in order to go up to B2. Or a variable with a negative weight in P2 means that that variable decreased. So a negative times a negative would also give you a positive. So your next plot to go take a look at after this one would be the loadings plot for P1 and P2. Now a loadings plot, what would that look like for the system? There's 150 variables. So a loadings plot is a bar plot with 150 coefficients in it. So it's you just go plot that up in the software and you find which coefficients in P2 had large positive or large negative weights. And then those would be the ones to go interrogate. Now actually most computer software that deals with multivariate data analysis makes it really easy to work with, because you can click on, what do they do is you go click on B and then you say, find me the difference between B and A, and then it goes and does that contribution plot to see what caused a move from A to B. And then you get this coefficient plot for the P2 vector, and then you double click on the bars in P2 and it shows you the time series vector. So it's really easy in the software to do. But if you have to do it manually, it's a little bit tedious. But that general approach is, you see I've moved from A to B, Y, what's in the P2 direction, I need a loading spot for P2, find the coefficients in P2, and then go look at the raw data in P2. So when we're looking at these score plots, we're looking for clusters, and we're looking for movements in time to understand how a process moves. This is a classical example of just learning more about your process. If you were a new engineer and you were assigned to this process, you would go withdraw data from the database for, say, the past 2-3 years, and look at it from a multivariate point of view to understand how the process shifts, rather than spending the time looking at univariate charts of all these 150 variables. You have a far better time looking at this sort of plot. The other way that you can use this is for troubleshooting. Say, for example, region A and B was normal process operation, and now you suddenly move to region C. Okay? What would you want to investigate to learn about how or why the process shifted from B to C? What would you look at in the loadings plot there? We're now looking at this diagonal shift from B. Why did we say region A and B is normal operation? Which of the 150 variables in your process changed to make you move to operating point C? Okay? You could go tediously plot out the time series plots for each of the 150 variables. And so you go look at temperature and so on, it does this. This would be region A, this would be region B, this would be region C. And you say, there's a move from region B to region C. At least this temperature variable is associated with that shift in the cluster. But so would 3 or 4 other temperatures be associated with it, and maybe 2 or 3 other pressure variables. But you would need to go screen 150 time series charts separately before you found them. With a PCA model, you would go look at which variables have their load-ins in this diagonal direction. So like we did for the pastries, you go and find the loadings, draw up your loadings plot and find the variables that are in the lower left and upper right-hand side corner. That narrows down your search from 150 variables to maybe 20 or 15 variables. You now have far fewer to consider to go find out what was correlated with it. It's not going to answer the question for you why the shift occurred. No computer software is going to do that for you, no matter what the software vendors claim. And they'll always claim our software will always give the solutions to you. They won't. At best, they'll just simplify the problem down to a smaller number of variables, and then you have to go use your head and some time to go interrogate and look at the plots like this for those far fewer number of variables. But it's at least a hell of a lot easier than looking at 150 variables. So when we plot small plots out, we're looking for clustering, we're looking for shifts in time. You could go and take this score plot and you could go color-coded by another variable. So maybe there's another variable of interest in the process. And you could then say color reds for low pressure operation, oranges for medium pressure operation, and greens for low pressure operation. And then color-code the score plot by a third variable to get a third piece of information. Like we did in the very first class in this course, we showed a scatter plot where we had circles of different sizes and circles of different colors. We're looking at two dimensions. These two dimensions explain the majority of the variation of the process, but we can go add a third dimension and a fourth dimension with color and the size of the circles on it. Okay, here's another example. This is a score plot in T1 and T2 from the room temperature data. I'll leave you to go look through that by yourself. Okay, so yeah, I think I've pretty much covered what I wanted to say there. For this food example, I just want to reiterate the way to interpret the loading spot is by using diagonally opposite variables through the origin. So in this particular example, there's nothing opposite hardness. If I go through the origin down hardness, there's nothing down here. So I would infer then that hardness is an independent variable that's able to move through the process by itself. Whereas these four variables, crispiness and oil, are positively correlated with each other, but they're also negatively correlated with the density fraction. And then just some final notes here on the squared prediction error. Once we've calculated the scores, we also calculate the SPE value. So in the second half of it, just before the break there, I had this diagram where for each observation we calculated T1, T2, maybe there's a T3, but there's also a column called SPE that we calculate. Okay? So this T1, T2, and 3 capture the locations of each observation on the plane. So the scores are on the plane. Okay. And then SPE is complementary in the sense that it's capturing off the plane. So T1, T2, and 3, if you had just three components, they would capture the variability. Remember, they are distances on the plane. So every observation has a T1, a T2, and a T3 value. Okay? That T1, T2, and 3 value gives you, just coming back to this diagram, the T1 value for this observation is over there. The T2 value for this observation is down here. But jointly, T1 and T2 give you this points, coordinates on that model plane. So this point has a high T1 value and a negative T1 value. So if I'm in two-dimensional space, if I've got two components rather, T1 and T2 would be the locations of each point on that plane. Okay? SPE would be the distance of that point off the plane. So then the scores capture on the plane variation for how far a point is on the plane from the model center. So a high T1 and a high T2 value indicates this point is far away from the origin. Okay. Whereas the SPE captures for me the distance off the plane. So one thing that we often do then is we plot SPE versus time. The same way that we plot T1 against time, we can plot SPE versus time. So here, for example, is the temperature data. Those four temperature sensors. If you recall, the raw data looks something like this, where there's this oscillation. So if I fit one component to this model, that one component describes this general up and down movement. But I can then also go calculate the square prediction error for each observation. So for example, that first observation is temperature 1, temperature 2, 3, and 4. I can calculate the square prediction error for that observation. SPE then, for that observation, is over here. SPE 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. And there's 144 observations in that data set. There's 144 points in time. So for each one of them, I can calculate an SPE value. If I plot that up, I can quickly see then these points, the smallest SPE that you can obviously have is zero. It's a distance, so you can't have a negative distance. So the smallest SPE is zero. You can calculate this limit, or let the software do that for you. And this is my 95% limit. So it says then that out of 100 data points, 95 will be below the limit, or 5 will be above the limit. So there's 144 here. I would expect, say, 5, 6, 7 points to lie above this limit, just from common cause operation. But this, I mean, this is clearly, like, clearly an unusual point, as is those. So what happened at time 50 to 60, as well as time period 133? Just by looking back at the raw data, you can see that there was this unusual dip over here. So the common trend is for it to oscillate like that, but for some reason at time 50 to 60, there was this dip in the temperature, and that last one was due to the spike. So the SPE picks up any inconsistencies with the data. So the scores capture the consistent variation in the model, and the SPE captures unusual operation in the process, or inconsistent operation. So high SPE values are an indicator to you that, look, there's something unusual with that data point. So this point has a high SPE, so does that one. So each of these points that have high SPEs, well, your natural question is to go ask why. Why is this point far off the model plane? Okay? Well, we can answer that quite easily. Remember how SPE was calculated was just the sum of squares of the errors. So if I plot back my E matrix, if I take a vector from this matrix, that vector is EI. Remember that SPE for that ith observation is EI transpose EI, sum of squares of the errors, and I take the square root. So if an observation, or another way to write this is EI1 squared plus EI2 squared up to EIK squared. So SP is the sum of those squares, and then I take the square root of that. We can generate a contribution plot for the squared prediction error as well. This is variables 1's contribution to the error. Variable 2's contribution to the error. Variable 3, 4, 5, and so on up to K. So if I see a high SPE, I'm asking, why is this point inconsistent with the model? Well, go back to how that SPE was calculated and expand this vector into the K original terms. There'll be K of them, one for each of the columns in the data set. So you'll plot, in this case there were 4 variables, but in a general data set there might be 60, 70 variables. And you'd go and plot a contribution plot or a bar plot for each of these errors inside that vector. And that should show you which of the original variables most contribute to this high STE. And for this observation 130, you would see that it's going to show temperature 3 as having the high STE. It indicates to you that sensor 3 went crazy at that point in time, went offline, or there's something unusual that meant that sensor 3 does not follow the usual relationship in the data. The same for this period of time. You go and plot the contribution plot up here, and I'll have this in the slides for the next part. I just didn't have time to generate it for this time. But if you generated the contribution plot for these observations, they would all show you that sensor 1 and 2 had something unusual within. Sensor 3 and 4 were kind of okay. So in that sense, then, we've got the scores that monitor or measure what's on the plank and what's normal operation. And the SPE is a measurement of off the plane or unusual in the data. So there are two great complementary metrics that quantify what's going on in the data. So we'll talk a lot about this in the next class, where we talk about process monitoring using multivariate data. And then also in the next class, is the final class of foundation. I will probably only spend an hour and a half on this material, and then I'll spend the last time just kind of pulling together all the six sections that we've covered in this course to show how they hang together. Because I've introduced a whole lot of tools through this past 4 months, 3 months for you. You've learned a ton of new material. I will try to show you how it all kind of hangs together, and we'll review material for the exam. Okay, so see you next week.